you here for. Thank you all for coming. People like you for coming to help people in business and help do this as much as we can and support the local authors. And so we have a request. He's a videotaping, and we want the people in the audience to know. Is that okay if he videotapes?
Absolutely.
Okay. Not the okay. All right. So this is a big honor for him. He volunteered for this project and put a lot of time and effort into it. And then now he is the root of his accomplishment. So let's give him a big hand of applause, guys.
All right. Well, thank you all for coming out. I'm glad you're able to make it. And definitely I'm happy about the book coming out. That's a big deal, so I'm glad that happened. Today, I'm going to do an overview, kind of give you a little bit of some of the highlights of the book, talk about some of the things that went on in making the book, and let me get into that. So first, I broke the book up into five things, because I wanted to create a book that gave not only just the history of Highlands Ranch, but kind of gave the flow of Highlands Ranch and how it evolved and how it came to be. So the book is set up with starting with the early homesteads, and then the most important homestead, talking about the mansion. We'll talk about that a bit. How they went on and developed the planned community. One of the big keys to the planned community, all the outdoor space and the outdoor activities that are available down there in Highlands Ranch. And then at the end, I wanted to capture as they started to move from just a housing division into a town, because that is kind of the latest chapter of Highlands Ranch. They're not incorporated yet. They're not officially a city. They're not officially a town. But they're getting that feeling. They're getting a lot of the services and stuff that you expect for one of those, and they're getting it all put in place. And so capturing that now, why it's all fresh, I wanted to do, because that's all going to be history here in the near future, and everyone's going to talk about, oh, I remember the day when that first came in. So first I want to give some acknowledgments. The book, an Arcadia book, is really driven by the photographs. So getting good photographs is key. And this is actually the sort of book I'm glad I was able to write, because having the photographs, you can tell the story, but I believe this is also, for the modern generation especially, the way that they like to listen to stories. They like to see photos, they like to read text. And actually, I was just listening to a CD earlier today that talked about trying to communicate with people. It said, tell stories in photographs, that if people can get a visual image in their mind, they're a lot easier to remember it. And that's what the book does. The book puts a photo in front of you, and then puts a few words. So I definitely like that. In order to get all these photos, I needed a lot of help. One of the big ones that helped with the old photos is the History Research Center down in Castle Rock. If you've ever been down there, it's at the Castle Rock Library, but they actually store the main history of Douglas County, at least all the books and things. They have a very environmentally controlled vault down there. And they do put away all the historic stuff for not only this generation, but years to come. They've also digitized all of the aerial maps. So if you go to Google Earth over Douglas County, you can actually go up to the timeline and drag back. All those maps, when you drag back, came from the History Research Center down in the library down there. So thanks to Blake and Sean for that. Next big one, Highlands Ranch Metro Districts. Terry Nolan, who's in charge of the Metro Districts, for being in charge of that and giving us permission, but the main person there probably, Jeff Case. Jeff Case is their head of civil works, but he also loves photographs. I think when I went down to try to get some photographs from him, he opened up his computer and had over 20,000 photographs sitting there. So there are lots of photos, so we're able to get some that I think helped tell the story. Sherry Eppers also helped us. The Highlands Ranch Mansion, Maggie Glass and Susie Appleby. Mansion is the key of Highlands Ranch. That, for most of its history, was kind of that unifying thread. Then we have the Highlands Ranch Community Association, one of the rangers there that helped me get the final closing photo of the book. That was very important to me to get that photo. The Philbert Museum, they provide us four or five photos of one of the ranch owners. The Douglas County Historic Preservation Board, Historic Douglas County, the William E. Griggs family, who actually provided us a photo, which you will see here tonight, which actually didn't make the book. It wasn't quite high enough resolution, but it's a photo that I think is actually very key and I don't want to lose to history. So I actually want to keep it in the presentation because I think it helps tell the story even if they wouldn't take it for the book because of its resolution. And then some of our proofreaders. Mark Stevenson, who sit Danny in the back filming, was one of my proofreaders. Robert Morse, who's also in the Historical Society. Sarah Lebowski and my brother-in-law, Michael Horn, all helped proofread this book. So got some different proofreaders in here. Also want to thank the other members of the Historical Society. Nancy, who was the president when we signed up for the book and then decided to leave, and I'm the one that stood up and volunteered for the book. She's still helping us with different things, but the book became my project. Paul does a lot of the logistics for the Historical Society, and then David Hill, who's not here, but he's kind of our webmaster. He put together the outside wrapper of all of our PowerPoint presentations and just keeps the website up and just gives us good common look and feel across all of our things. And with that, I'm going to go on a little bit more. Next, let me give you a little bit about me before I go into the actual presentation about this. I grew up right outside Highlands Ranch. If you know the intersection of Dry Creek and Quebec, that's where I was since the age of 5. So I grew up there and then eventually went off to college and started living around. Actually, I forgot to put that one in there. Now I'm actually currently living in Highlands Ranch over on by the Western Track Center. But I went to school locally, Cherry Creek High School, up to CU Boulder, and then up to the University of Denver. I work right now as Director of Software Engineering Program Management. I'm also the Chairman of the Douglas County Historic Preservation Board right now. I'm a Highlands Ranch Mansion docent, and I was just actually looking at that because Highlands Ranch Days is coming up, so I wanted to try to sign up because it's like one of two or three times in the entire year I actually get to do it. It's a problem of working during the day. Let's see. And then part of the Highlands Ranch Historical Society membership, I do membership director, I'm the secretary, and I'm also the historian on the Historical Society. So I have several hats there that I wear. And then why did I write this book? I wrote this book mostly for my daughter who's sitting in the audience because her entire life has been in Highlands Ranch, and I wanted her to have the history of where she grew up. So that was one of my big inspirations for actually writing the book. All right, so with that, let's jump into a little bit about the book. The first thing I wanted to do, and this is one of the things that fascinated me, and I'll try to do more research on this even into the future, is the homesteads. Highlands Ranch, like everywhere out in the West, started with a bunch of homesteads. They were all 40 to 160 acres under the Homestead Act. So how all these just hundreds of homesteads started to come together. And really when you saw it start to come together, it really came together into like five major homesteads. Four of them are right here that I started with. You have in the upper left is the Cheese Ranch. In the upper right is the Failing Douglas Investment Company. And those two photos were taken probably in around 1980 or early 80s when those photos were taken. The bottom left, that's the one photo that didn't make the book, but I think it's there. But as you can see, it looks a little grainy because the only copy was in a book down at the History Research Center. They had a copy of this photo. And even when we tried to go back to the original family that submitted it to be put in the book, they had lost the photo. So they no longer had that copy of the photo anymore. So I want to keep it captured, even if it is a little bit lower resolution, because it does show what is the Griggs homestead, which they call the Pine Tree Ranch. So it is a good photo of what it looked like when it was actually operating. And then the bottom right is the Plews homestead. That was built in 1906, and that's right at the corner. And that one has an interesting side thing, is the one that you could almost say is really not part of Highlands Ranch because it didn't become part of Highlands Ranch until they donated the house to become a park. And I think that was either 2003 or 2005 is when they finally did that donation to make it a part of Highlands Ranch. It was the one that was just outside of Highlands Ranch the whole time. And I know Roxborough, at least in one presentation I saw, they kept claiming that this was their area, but I didn't notice when I looked through the Roxborough book, they did not mention it or show it. So apparently they're not claiming it in their history, but they did claim it on the map of one place. But to me, it is Highlands Ranch because, in my mind, Highlands Ranch is pretty much all the stuff from like 470 between Quebec, Santa Fe, all the way down through the Bluffs. And that, in my mind, is what I think of as the historic Highlands Ranch area. And almost all that was Highlands Ranch. And now, and for the homesteads, what I did was I did kind of a past and a present view. So that's the past photos. Here's what they look like today. The cheese ranch in the upper left has been completely leveled. There's nothing left of it. It's an empty park, an empty field. Metro District's put a windmill up there and a couple signs that says that this is where Cheese Ranch once stood. So that's what happened to Cheese Ranch. In the upper right, the Douglas Investment Company, we saw that barn that they started with in the early 80s. Well, the barn, as you can see, has been falling apart. So that one has got some problems. But if you look, behind the barn is the silo. The silo was built in 1920. And the silo, through its construction or through whatever materials they use on that silo, still is in actually pretty good shape. So hopefully they can do something to maintain at least the silo part down there. And then there's a couple, there's a, several outbuildings that are in various states of condition in that same area. In the bottom left is the Griggs Homestead. Another one of those, you can still make out the same house, but likewise, they haven't really kept that up since they took it over in the 80s. And so time and weather has gotten to it. And in the bottom right is the Plues, which is also called the Flying Bee. And as you can see, the house is in good condition. Metro Districts, at this point, has got the funding to restore the outside or to stabilize the outside, so it's going to stay, the outside's going to still look good. When Windcrest expands, and last I just looked coming down the highway, I saw all sorts of cranes there, so I'm wondering if they finally got their funding for that. They're going to get more funding from Windcrest to actually try to finish off at least the first floor and probably actually renovate the inside and just make it a one-level thing so they can hold community events and stuff inside the old house. And in the bottom right, as you can see, the lands of the Flues Flying Bee is the Windcrest development. So development goes on. Those empty fields are no longer there. Next, we go to the central homestead, which drove Highlands Ranch for many years and was a consolidation point, which was the mansion. And I'm going to talk to the mansion first through the mansion owners. You have Samuel Long. He started in 1884 to 1897, and he was actually the one that they didn't even realize was a mansion owner. They thought Springer was the first mansion owner until they just actually started the remodel. And then the date on the house did not match when they knew Springer showed up. So they started going back and they did research and they found out it was actually Samuel Long, who was a board member at the B&O Railroad that actually did Highlands Ranch. And B&O Railroad from the old Monopoly game. That was actually where he was in. And he called it Rotherwood. Then you had John Springer. He came out. He had money. He did some expansions, which we'll see on the next slide. But he called it the Springer Cross Country Horse and Cattle Ranch. And he actually renamed the house to Castle Isabel after his second wife, who unfortunately his second wife also got into a big scandal that actually ended up being the murder at the Brown Palace in 1911, and I'm sure that book is probably also around here in the Tattered Cover somewhere, that if you want to look that one up. That's a whole book in and of itself, but that also was kind of the end of his political career, was after that scandal broke. And so, what did he do? He sold the ranch back to his first father-in-law. And so his first father-in-law was Colonel William Hughes. And so Colonel William Hughes took over the ranch, and had the ranch for a while, called it Sunland Ranch, and then with his passing, it passed down to John Springer's daughter and Colonel Hughes' granddaughter, Annie Clifton Springer Hughes, and she turned around and then sold the ranch a couple years later. And she sold it to Wade Phillips, which I know that I had some people asking me about that before I got here, but he came in, he had his oil money, so early 20s, he came in, bought the ranch, and he's the one that gave it its name, or as close to the name as we get, or at the beginning, it's Phillips Highland Ranch. He didn't have the S, but had a lot of good history to it, and that's where the name kind of came from. After that, Frank Kistler came along in the late 20s and renamed it the Diamond K Ranch, did a major remodel that we'll see in a minute. But one of the things that he did was he also bought it for about $450,000 in the middle of the 20s, roaring 20s, ended up having to sell it during the Depression for $250,000, so he took quite a loss on the mansion overall. But then that got us to the longest term owner, Lawrence Phillips Jr., who owned it from 38 to 76 when he passed away. But he actually called it Phipps Highlands Ranch, and he lived there, he worked there, that was his place, that was his ranch, and he really enjoyed it. But as I was talking about the owners, when we talk about the succession of the owners, the other thing that is really neat about this homestead and the mansion that becomes the mansion is the progression. Rarely have I seen a house ever change this much. If you look, there's the very first A-frame house that is up there in the corner. That is what the original homestead house looked like. And you can still see that that same A-frame is in the picture right below it, just next to the main turret, when it's Castle Isabel. So they didn't tear down the original house to build the next one. They just built onto it. So then you go off to Castle Isabel, and it's a little bit larger. Then you can see where it got expanded even further, and it goes all the way out. And at the very far end, there's actually three stories. You don't actually see that today. At some point, they lost that third story. We're not exactly sure the story why. I think the mansion is still trying to investigate exactly where the third story went, and I'm sure once we hear about it, we'll get that story. It'll be a nice one. And at the very bottom is when Phillips owned it. And then that is, you can see the third story, you can see that PH over on the barn on the left. And if you start getting up there close, I've actually spotted three or four people, and there's some running sheep and other things that are all in the foreground that you have to look at. And I'll probably talk about that a little bit more when we do our presentation in a month. And then in the upper right is Kistler. Kistler came in and changed the nature of the house. He got rid of that Russian castle feel and gave it a more modern feel, a more European feel, is what he went with. And today, it just underwent a remodel. There is the mansion today. It's in great condition, and you can still see that original house is still there as part of the full building of the mansion. And as we talk about the mansion life, this is another area that I like to highlight, is just the difference in the mansion. In the upper left, you can see, I believe that was under Springer, where it's very much a hunting lodge. There's stone chairs right next to the fireplace. You can see the windows in the back, and you can see the rocking chairs. One of the things I think is neat is if you look at the pictures in the upper left and the upper right, same rocking chairs. So when they sold the house, at this point they sold the furniture with the house. So they didn't swap it out. But the ones in the upper right is when Wade Phillips owned the house. And that's his son Elliot, who was actually sitting on a live horse on top of a bearskin rug in the middle of the living room. So, and whoever is standing just off camera, you can see he's actually standing on a mountain lion rug. So there's definitely a lot of stuff going on, and there's the hunting field. And this is what you got until Kistler came. The bottom row, Kistler came through, and he switched it more into a high society house. You now have the luxurious living room, you have the grand dining room, and then on the right, you have the solarium, or the white room, as they call it. And talking about your money there, a polar bear rug. I don't know how often you ever see polar bear rugs, and that must be awfully hard to keep a polar bear rug white. But I guess it goes with the white room. Next, after the mansion, moved into the planning of Highlands Ranch. And one of the things I like in here is you can actually see the original plan from 1979. And if you know anything about the roads of Highlands Ranch, it actually looks very similar to that today. They've changed a few of the roads around, they changed some of the other ones, but how close to their original plan from 35 years ago, they're still at. Is that 35? Yeah. So that's a long way back.
So what are some of the roads?
These roads in this plan never truly got made, but what you see here is came up with this big idea of a loop road.
Yeah.
But if you think about where the roads go today, between Highlands Ranch Parkway, University, which turns into Lincoln, and then Wildcat, between those three roads, it does make almost that same loop road that they originally envisioned in their original plans. And then you do see kind of green going from the lower left to the upper right. There's kind of like a green line that cuts through there. That's actually the Denver Aurora water pipelines that go right through Highlands Ranch. So they can't build on top of those, so that's a dedicated open space is where the water pipelines go right through the middle of the city. But you can see in that little picture in the upper corner what it looked like. It was just empty grasslands. And then these are the two people most known for bringing Highlands Ranch to what it is today. You have Phil Riley, who was in charge of Mission Viejo, that was in charge of all the homes nationwide. And then you have Jim Teffer, who's considered the father of Highlands Ranch. He's the one that was put in charge of making Highlands Ranch Highlands Ranch. So they sent him out here, gave him this big empty field, and said, go make something out of it. And this idea of all these different homes. And you can see some of the pictures in the lower left where they're talking with the planning commission and just all the approvals they had to go through to get there. So next you started with the homes. So the first homes came in 1981. You can actually see Phil and Kay Scott up there in the corner. They're actually signing for what is officially the first home. I do believe I have heard many stories that there was a person that worked for Shea Homes that actually bought a home 2 days earlier, but they didn't want to make him the official first person. So Phil and Kay Scott are the official first people to get a home in Highlands Ranch. And what I didn't realize is I always thought it was in this corner right down in the bottom, right in that center photo, right by the corner of Dad Clark and Broadway. But it actually isn't. The first homes were actually further back down Broadway, past where the rec center is, in just south of the rec center, is where the actual first homes were sold and purchased. So I think that's an interesting little side fact. A few other pictures of early Highlands Ranch, including the sign that talks about how the homes were for the 70s, 80s, and 100s. So home prices back in 81. And of course, when you do that, you get lots of construction. So you can see where they're literally out there building Highlands Ranch Parkway in the middle of nowhere. It's empty fields, but they know that the roads are coming. They build the roads up front. Just lots of construction. Bottom left, I thought were those big Denver Aurora pipelines that I was telling you about. Though when I talked to Jeff Case and I made that mention to Jeff Case, Jeff Case said, oh no, those are, I think he said 11 feet in diameter. So he's like, yeah, these are about as tall as the people. So he said, oh, those are just normal storm drains in the community. So underneath all your communities, you have big storm drains that look like that. So I think that's kind of interesting to know. And then the two on the right are actually C-470 before it opens. And C-470 was a key to opening up all of the southern side of the metro area to traffic. And so that was their initial construction. Another thing that they needed for people when they moved in, schools. So I have lots of schools in here. The one top, second, over is Northridge Elementary. That is the first elementary school. There's other elementary schools. I did a combination of some private, some charter, some public to give you kind of a flair of the different schools. And then I went through and captured all five of the main high schools that are in Highlands Ranch, because if someone's going to come from Highlands Ranch and they're going to remember their experience, odds are most likely they're going to remember the high school that they went to or that they visited or their kids went to. So the center one is Highlands Ranch High School. The right one is Thunder Ridge. Bottom left, Mountain Vista. I was trying to capture that vista with Mountain Vista. Then you have Rock Canyon in the bottom center. And of course, Valor, the brand new one.
You just started there as a freshman.
Ah. They have nice buildings. There's a lot to say about Valor. So lots of good schools in Douglas County area. The other thing that Highlands Ranch got was rec centers. And you got a couple pictures here of the early Northridge Rec Center. And with the early Northridge Rec Center, one of the things you can see is it's how small it is. This is before they had a lot of the tennis courts, before they had the indoor pool, before they had the basketball court. This is very, very basic rec center is what they started with. And that was the original Northridge Rec Center sign. I asked a couple other ones to get people in that frame of mind. You got one of the Eastridge kind of inside where a lot of kids go and they play the big old frog pool that everyone is there. People know that one. They're year round. Then their kids run off energy. Westridge in the bottom left, and then Southridge where we hold our nightly meetings in the bottom right, or our monthly meetings. The other thing was activities, and just some of the interesting stuff about the activities that they had back then. You have in the top center Art Cook. He was known as the voice of Highlands Ranch, but he was the one that brought everybody together, got everyone out for activities, and gave it a sense of community. The upper left, I think that's interesting, they actually used to brand cattle right there in front of the people that were in Highlands Ranch. And they actually ran cattle. I believe now they're just down to doing mostly horses, and they don't have a lot of cattle that they do on the ranch anymore. And then you have a bunch of the things. I always remember one time going and hearing a comedian, and one of his jokes about Highlands Ranch was, well, what do you guys ranch down there? Kids. That's what people ranch in Highlands Ranch nowadays. Lots of kids. And that stuck with me. I'm like, that is so true. But a couple other ones. Well, the Olympics on tonight, the Olympic torch, when it was in Salt Lake City, actually ran through Highlands Ranch. So that came through the area. And in the upper right, one that I didn't know, is Mission Viejo Company was actually owned by the Philip Morris Company. And so they used to have Miller Lite, and a lot of those sponsor a lot of their early events. So that's why you have the huge Miller Lite can that was sitting in the background of one of their early events. All right. Parks and open space. Just left of the open space, that they get some of the separation between the homes. The bottom left one, just how they can use it for flood control, that they've set aside these areas so when it rains or it floods, that it can capture the water and release it at a reasonable pace so you don't get a lot of flooding downstream from Highlands Ranch. And then just the guy going over the plan in the beginning. I heard during a previous presentation, they say that Highlands Ranch build-out is supposed to be 60% open space. And they said that build-out should complete around 2020, and they're still on track to have 60% of it being open space. You might not feel it, might not seem it, but with all the open spaces, and especially with the massive backcountry area that they set aside, that they're still on track to do that. Talking about the backcountry area, put that in the book too. A lot about backcountry. And even when I went into backcountry, you get the great vistas, but in the bottom left, found some great geological stuff. And they just had cool stone that was just sitting there that had, was out. And then the bottom right, mountain biking. So, good mountain biking shot. The other part, that might recharge your spirit being out in the environment. Well, here's recharging your spirit if you want to actually go to churches. I captured a few dozen churches, but these were some of them. I got Big Cherry Hills, and I got St. Andrews, a couple of the mega churches that are in Highlands Ranch. Pax Christi is, or yeah. Pax Christi is in the upper left. And then the bottom right, there's the Mormon church, there's St. Mark's, and it's a Lutheran church that's on the bottom right. I think it's Holy Cross Lutheran Church, if I remember right, is the third one.
Christ Lutheran.
Oh, Christ Lutheran is that one? Oh, okay. Got a correction.
And St. Luke's next to it.
See?
Which is Methodist.
Is it on Broadway?
No, this is not on Broadway. This is on Wildcat.
Yes. We're talking about different ones.
Yeah, different ones. Yeah. This is the one on Wildcat. So.
I went to St. Andrew when it was over by the rec center on University.
Huh.
And we helped start St. Luke's.
That one right there that's photographed is the Holy Cross Lutheran Church. Is that one. Okay. Then once we passed churches, the other thing I wanted to capture was some businesses. And when I captured the businesses, this slide right here already has two of the changes that I've talked about since I wrote the book. You got the big super target, so I captured kind of something like that. What does a modern shopping center look like? So I captured that one. You got the town center, which is up in the center. And in the upper right, Tattered Cover, who already left. They came over here, so that one came and went. And that one, I can talk about that more later, but that is one that I wanted to leave in the book, even though they were only there 10 years, because when Tattered Cover came in, it was a huge debate about large stores and large corporations and large brands versus small ones. So it was a center point for the entire discussion about what Town Center is, what Town Center would be, and everything else. So from that point of view, I think it had a lot of historical significance. And the fact that they're no longer there and over here, that also tells you what the people of Highlands Ranch chose with their wallets in the end. And then the bottom left one, the King Supers. I like that photo, but that is one of my other changes because they were open 24 hours. Not anymore, because I think the economy's probably recovered, and I think they were having problems finding overnight help with probably a better economy. So they've chosen not to be open 24 hours anymore.
Which King Supers?
That's the one on Wildcat that I captured. I believe I have three of them in the book, because that was another one, kind of like high schools, as I like to capture most of the grocery stores, because that is a place that almost everybody goes, and so everybody has a feel to their local grocery store, being there or going there. And the bottom right was just one of the big businesses right there on Lucent. Emergency and medical, captured some of the fire stations. This is one of my favorites. It's an action shot. As I was coming up to take that photo, literally was about 20 feet away from where I was going to take the photo. All of a sudden, all the fire trucks started moving. So I had to run that last 20 feet and get in position, but I actually got all the fire trucks as they were driving away in the middle of my photo. So I do like the photo for that aspect. Got some action I wasn't even expecting. And then you have the sheriff's station, you have Kaiser, and I got Children's Hospital in here. One of the things this also shows in some of the photos that I like is all the clouds. For some reason, when I was photographing this, there's a lot of clouds, and clouds, especially when we get into the black and white photos, gives a good depth into the sky. Mm-hmm. A blue sky on black and white photos just looks really boring. All right. Then I also captured some current activities. You have some of the stuff at Highlands Heritage Park over here, and this was a concert at the end of last summer. This is when the $8 million band showed up, so you can got a good photo of the band playing, but you also see all the people and all the kids on the fields. So it's just neat to see the whole community came out here. And this, to me, was where we saw some of those small ones where they had like a gathering on the mansion grounds. This is the modern one, is where a town where literally they're filling entire soccer fields and hills around the soccer fields with people. That many more have now come into Highlands Ranch. And then the ones on the right are some of the same events that they hold down at Civic Center Park. So, in conclusion, I'm glad we got to get the book out about Highlands Ranch. It's available stores, online, at the Highlands Ranch Mansion, rec centers, at all of our Highlands Ranch Historical Society events, which we do one every third Monday. And I went through, when I dedicated the book, I dedicated this book to everyone who takes place or part in making Highlands Ranch history, which includes all the people who've lived there, worked there, visited, or even taken part in an event. Everyone who's ever been there is part of the history. And I want people to realize their key role. So, thank you very much.
First question, is Windcrest considered part of Highlands Ranch? Or, it's yeah. Ambiguous too, but is it technically yeah. part of
South of County Line and east of Santa Fe?
It is in my logical things. If we were to go back and find out the exact lines, I would have to go check with Metro Districts. I know they deeded over the house that's right there, the Flying Bee houses. Part of Metro Districts, so that's part of Highlands Ranch. My guess is Windcrest has probably kept themselves as their own little separate thing just outside of Highlands Ranch. So in my heart, I kind of believe them as part of Highlands Ranch, but if you were to do it actually by the lines, I think it's slightly outside. I know Jeff Case was talking about that a lot of the apartment buildings that are on the north side of 470 are technically outside of Highlands Ranch, but like the Census Bureau and everyone else considers them part of Highlands Ranch. Census Bureau goes all the way up to County Line Road, and what the Census Bureau considers part of Highlands Ranch, and even the post office. But Jeff Case, who works for Metro District, said technically a lot of those apartment buildings are not there, and my guess is Windcrest probably falls into that same category.
Windcrest is south of C-470.
Yeah, well, it's south, but it was a separate ranch. It was that Flying Bee Ranch, and so they weren't part of the original ranch. They weren't part of what Mission Viejo owned. And so unless they decided to choose to join, which places do, we saw like Park Meadows join Lone Tree because they wanted to get better police and fire and other things. So they could join, but Highlands Ranch really isn't a city yet. But if they wanted to be part of Metro Districts, they could.
That's what I'm having trouble with. It's not a city, not a governmental entity. So the people who live there, everybody's in some city. Multiple cities that...
It's not multiple cities. It's technically unincorporated Douglas County. It's unincorporated Douglas County is where Highlands Ranch lives.
Oh, really?
Highlands Ranch has its own postal code. The post office recognizes Highlands Ranch as a postal area. And they have Metro Districts. So Metro Districts is a recognized taxing authority. So you can say they don't have a city government, but they do have a taxing authority that's been put in place to maintain the roads and the open spaces and the parks. So it is their pseudo-governmental agency. But I know that there's been a big debate over the years about whether Highlands Ranch should incorporate. And now, if you look at the business and everything else, it's got all the elements of it. But one of the big questions that keeps being asked is, what are you missing? And for most of the residents of Highlands Ranch, they're like, well, we have what we need. And as soon as you incorporate, normally your taxes go up by like 3 or 4%, like around 3% or so. As soon as you incorporate. So they're like, well, what do you want to pay an extra 3% to get that you don't have? So the residents of Highlands Ranch, for the most part, have decided not to incorporate at this point.
So where does the tax base come to support all the typical, you know, normal city services, fire, police, da-da-da, you know?
Fire is through Metro Districts, and that comes out of the taxing authority, so I think it's sales taxes on all the businesses and stuff that are in there. I don't know if there's a separate property tax or not. I'd probably have to look at my property tax. But police is still through Douglas County. It's the Douglas County Sheriff's Office is who provides police.
And schools are?
Schools are Douglas County School District.
Rather than a city school district, as I'm used to in my suburban area.
It's different than city schools, but even here in Colorado, a lot of school districts don't always follow county boundaries, but a lot of them do. Because I know Boulder County does their own schools, Jefferson County does their own schools. You have Douglas County schools. Cherry Creek follows a lot of Arapahoe County, but not all of Arapahoe County. So there are different areas. And then you do have a few, like Littleton Public Schools. The city of Littleton did separate from Cherry Creek Schools, and so they, as a city, have their own school district. So some cities have school districts. A lot of times they've just left them with the county. And so it's a kind of combination.
The thing I don't see is any major heavy industry, I guess by design, or?
There is no heavy industry. Right now you have...
No big office towers, right?
There's a few bigger office towers starting to come in. The ones that we had that one photo that you have, the ones along that are Lucent. There's
okay.
Others that are kind of on the east side of Highlands Ranch that they're more office and high-tech related, but they are a very solid income base for Highlands Ranch. There's others in there. There's medical ones. I believe right behind the Target, they just broke ground on, I'm trying to remember what that was. I saw it in the newspaper. I thought it was like $800 million hospitals complex they're about to build in there. So there's going to be a massive hospital complex that goes right into the center of Highlands Ranch.
It seems like this is almost a unique entity in the metro areas I've ever lived across the country. It's much different.
It is. It's, and a lot of people commute. That was, I can't remember if I had that in the book or not, but
yeah.
One of the ones that Terry Nolan was saying in one of our meetings is, I want to say it was almost 3/4 of the population of Highlands Ranch leaves every day to go to work. That they go to either the tech center or they go to downtown.
Right.
That there's just a lot of them that go out. And it was a very large number. And so it's, you have a huge population that goes out and every day goes to work and then comes back to Highlands Ranch in the evening.
And a lot of people who work in Highlands Ranch can't afford to buy a house in Highlands Ranch. They commute in.
They're commuting the other direction on the highways.
Interesting.
So, but you do have some of those out in the California area where, like, Mission Viejo, that's where they originally started, was they did a big complex like this out in California, where they all commute out for jobs and then they come back.
And that was the major developer, Mission Viejo, I think you mentioned.
Mission Viejo was the major developer for the majority of time. They started in 81, and I believe it was in the mid-90s that they sold out to Shea Homes, who continued the development to the present.
Are they still building today, or is there any land left to build homes on?
They're still building. There's a little bit left in backcountry. If you go all the way down Broadway until it dead ends,
okay.
At the very south end, there is a little more area to build out there. There's probably a few more apartments or more dense stuff. There's a few small pockets left near town center and a couple other areas. And then their big final build out is the businesses of town center, or in the town center north area, the area behind Target, some of the other items. Based on the Fast Tracks bill, there's supposed to be a light rail stop that eventually comes in right next to Children's Hospital, that this Santa Fe line is supposed to be extended down there.
Continues up.
Yeah, of course it was supposed to be there like this year, next year, when the tax was originally passed, and now I'm sure they have something like 2040 or 2050 that they are going to finally put those two stops in.
385 apartments will be finished in November. Most of them are occupied already on just south of County Line, across from No-No's, if you're familiar with
that
kitty corner from that. And then what's just west of Children's Hospital?
I'm trying to think of what they're putting in there. I want to say that might be another set of apartments or townhomes that is going in there right next to where the light rail station is going to be.
Huge, huge development.
Yeah, the light rail station is going to be right in between those two, is where it's supposed to be. It's supposed to go. And RGD already owns that land. They just don't have a plan to actually build to it at the moment. Other questions?
I have one.
Okay.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but people feel that Highlands Ranch
itself is one of the faster growing communities. We're really, a lot of times they are referring to as Douglas County. Is Douglas County for many years has been one of the fastest growing counties in the whole country. It's normally been either number one or in the top three for like the last 20 years. And that's part of it is Highlands Ranch, and I talk about that a little bit in the books. If you look at Highlands Ranch itself, back in 1980, it had 100 people living in all of Highlands Ranch. Now you have almost 100,000 people living in Highlands Ranch. So you have that growth, but you've seen that same growth in Douglas County. And I don't remember the exact numbers, but I want to say it was something like 1980 was around 14 or 15,000 people. And now you probably at least 500,000 by the time you count all the different communities that have come up with Parker and everything else. I'm not a statistician on all of the county, but I'd have to say that it's just exploded. And not only that, but it also has a lot of good high-paying jobs. It's one of the richest counties in the whole nation, too. Actually, when I saw something that had the per capita, I think it was income of different counties, Douglas County was like in the top 10 in the nation, and all the rest were either in the D.C. or New York City area. So there's just a lot that's coming in. There's a lot, and a lot of that comes out of the tech center and all the jobs that the tech center has generated over the years and all the high-tech companies in the tech center have generated.
Windcrest now has 1,200 residents. And still growing.
1,201. I just committed myself there today.
Oh!
Good.
Yeah. So.
I keep trying to figure out what a set of buildings are that have red roofs. And if you're coming east from Santa Fe on C-470.
Just past the Flying Bee Park?
It's what?
Is it the one just past the Flying Bee Park?
Yeah. I think I know which buildings you are talking about. Red, wait, are they red tile roofs or kind of like a red steel? Are you on the north or south side of the highway?
It's on the south side.
South side. I think those might be part of the water group that is there. Mark's nodding his head, so I'm guessing that that's what it is. Because I know just on the other side is where the big water treatment plant is, the Joseph Blake Water Treatment Plant, which is actually in the book and his picture's in there. And I think those are support buildings that support whatever operations they have there. They've been here since I moved
in,
so I haven't seen them. Yeah, I guess they're probably sealed off to people that need to be there. But yeah, and that was actually one of the stories with that I did hear was the Flying Bee when they first opened it, right along where some of those buildings are. They used to have a runway. And when they first opened the C-470, they were still flying planes. And so they would come in for planes, and the sheriff kept talking about how they kept getting complaints that planes were crashing right next to C-470. It's like, no, there's a runway there. They're landing. They're not crashing. Since then, they've ceased to do that. Yeah.
I understand that you're going to be talking at the next Historical Society meeting in September.
Yes, I will. That's coming up September 19th. And I did stop on probably maybe about a third of the photos that I'm probably going to go more in depth on as I went through this presentation, but I probably have at least two-thirds more, and that's probably going to be more of that presentation. I'm going to take a few photos, blow up a little bit more, and talk a little about them and some of the stuff that we learned while we were researching them. Because that was one of the neat things is as you got some of these photos, the other questions that came up or the other insights that you learned from different people that you would have never even thought to ask that question until all of a sudden there's a photo and someone's like looking at it. And they're like, well, what's that? Or, oh, did you notice this in the photo? Like that one with all the people at the bottom of the fifth one is actually just saw one the other day. I had seen the person on the horse. There's a person on a horse. There's a person on the buggy. It's actually on this photo here too that's up here for questions. But you have a person on the horse in front, a person on the buggy kind of to the left, but right down along the wall, I noticed there's another person standing there. I thought it was a fence post, and all of a sudden I started looking at him like, that's actually a person standing there right next to that tree. That's not a fence post.
Oh.
And then, of course, you get the computer, and you blow it up, you can zoom in, and you're like, yep, that is definitely a person standing there in the shadows. But those are just things you'd never find.
I thought your little anecdote about how they publish these books, and the very back pages, how many they've done across the country.
Yeah.
They have a standard format of, 127 pages?
Yep.
That's it?
127 pages, 1 to 2 photos per page.
There are probably hundreds of these books about different places across the country.
There are, but lucky for us, ours is hardback. There's not many that are actually
that's
hardback.
That's right, a lot of them are soft cover.
Yep.
I know there are several in my community, that's why I was familiar. I spotted it.
Oh yeah, and probably the soft cover will probably come out. I think they're looking at somewhere around Christmas time. They'll put the soft cover version out too. But they did feel like ours was a community that could actually sell more of the hardcover books, and I'm glad for it because it actually makes it almost like a little coffee table book that you can leave out,
right,
and it
right.
does look like that. So I really enjoy the book because of it. My copies are hardcover right now. I'm sure I'll get a soft copy cover also, but
yeah.
These are the ones I have to start with.
How long did it take you to write this?
The process took about a year to write, and then it was about another 6 months before they actually released it. So basically I got the project, so thought about it for like a month, then probably the biggest first thing was spent about a month writing the outline, because I just wanted to try to get a good grasp of how I was going to tell the history of Highlands Ranch, because I knew I wanted to do the old history, the mansion history, the early community, and modern history, and so trying to figure out how to flow all that together and make it smooth was one of my big things. Then it took probably 2 to 3 months of gathering photos. And after I gathered the photos, well, there wasn't nearly as much in the old history, so actually there used to be a chapter before the homestead that I was going to have, and that ended up being like a photo or two, so that whole chapter kind of got cut, because I just could not find photos to support it. And that's, the pro or con is that's the thing with the Arcadia books, is you have to find photos to support it, otherwise you can write about it in the introduction, but you really need a photo to be able to support talking about it. And I didn't have that for the early history. So that was probably the next 3 months. Then I probably spent 3 or 4 months writing captions, just going like mad, writing all the captions, getting the book into a draft form. And as I said, you have to edit it down to probably like 200, 250 photos. That process of getting like, you can start with like 400 or 500 photos, and then you bring it down to like 300. You're like, these are the 300 I really want to tell the story. And then all of a sudden you realize, I still got to chop a third of these out. And then it really gets you to focus on what is the story I want to tell, and how do I want to tell the story, and do I need 5 photos to tell the story, or can I do 4? And some of that's also the layouts, because if you notice as I go through the book, a lot of the layouts I try to get with, whether it's owners or businesses or churches or whatever I'm doing, that when you open a page, all 4 photos on that page work together, and especially that the 2 photos on any page work together. So there was a lot of my mind where I was editing photos to make sure that each page or each time you open pages, that everything that was there worked, and that everything that was there was kind of associated to each other. And so coming up with some of those associations. And then after that, it was probably like 3 or 4 months of, I submitted it, didn't hear from them for 2 months, then it came back, you had proofreading, you submitted it, you came back, you had more proofreading, they threw in things that didn't come. Which includes, that final photo in the back. Because most of the photos that I took, which is probably about a third of the photos, all the ones that don't have another caption on it, was the one from the top of Wildcat Mountain. Well, I took most of my photos with my iPhone, and it was doing great with photos. But the one from Wildcat Mountain, they came back and said, if you want this to be a 2-page spread, that photo's not high enough quality. You need to go find another camera and get up there. Well, this is where, when I went to try to get back up there, the eagle closure was in place, and so I couldn't actually get up there. And so that's where I had to actually work with the rangers to actually get special permission to go up there and get that photo retaken. I'm like, I just want this one photo. Here's exactly what I'm looking for. I even sent them the first photo I had taken. They're like, oh, we don't have one like that. And then they finally said, well, if you're going to be very quiet and just walk straight there and straight back, you can go take it. So I had to give them the time I was going to do it and everything else, and then I was able to go out there and get the last photo. And that was the closing photo of the book, which I'll talk about that more when I do the Historical Society thing. And it's hard to see here. It was even hard to see when I took it. But a lot, there's like the ridgeline of Highlands Ranch and just the number of things you can actually spot from the top of Wildcat Mountain when you really zoom in with the computer or something that's along there, to know that all that is visible. And that means all those people can actually see back to the mountain also. So that's one of the other things that I'm kind of excited about. And that's probably what I'll actually close my next presentation with, is about how you can see these things on the horizon of Highlands Ranch.
All right, this is my next book.
With blown up images for that part. All right.
Now, when you do this presentation at the Historical Society, you'll have a larger screen, won't you?
There'll be a larger screen, a larger venue. We are in their main auditorium. Their main auditorium is probably about half, I'd say almost about half the size of this bookstore. They have a very big auditorium there, so it's got a big screen. We'll be up front. We'll have our members. Hopefully we'll get great attendance. So our normal attendance a lot of times is around between 100 and 200 people. So it just depends upon the program and how many people show up. So there'll be a lot of people up there. But it'll be a big screen. But the other one is because that program, I was going to talk more about individual photos and spend a lot more time on individual photos, is each photo I'll have as full screen so that I can spend time just talking about that one photo and kind of going into the details of that one photo and why that photo is special to me to put in the book. Even though I did go through quite a few of them tonight because I do enjoy it.
So you're moving into Windcrest, huh?
Yep, in next June.
Oh, next June.
I'm in the new building under construction.
Okay, they haven't built your place yet.
Well, it's partially. The outside is done. The infill, of course, is still
working on.
We're still working on. So it'll be next June before anybody gets into that building.
I see.
I'm looking forward to it.
Well, good. Yeah.
My son and his family just live in Littleton, and they're thinking of moving to Highlands Ranch, which is why I said, right. Read about the book signing done. I said, well, it'd be a nice present for them,
uh-huh,
for my grandson to give to his mom and dad when they move into their new house, whatever that may be.
Yeah.
So that was method behind my madness. how late is your store open?
We open until 9.
Okay, because I had another couple books to look for. So. Thank you very much. Good show.
Yes. Bye now.
Okay, thanks.